Hi all, I'm Dan Smegrod, founder of the We Get Around Network Forum. Today is Thursday, April 23rd, 2020, and you're watching WGAN TV Live at 5. We have a great show for you today, super geeky. This is automating and exporting Matterport Matter tags and exporting Matterport labels. We have a subject matter expert on the topic today is Scott McKenzie. Hey, Scott, good to see you.
Good to see you too, Dan. Thank you.
Scott is the director of Home Plan in Lower Hutt, New Zealand. Scott, your company Home Plan has automated some tools to facilitate the automating of Matterport, automating exporting of Matterport Matter tags and importing Matterport Matter tags. Before we kind of do a little bit deep dive into actually how this works, why would I need to be able to automate importing and exporting Matterport Matter tags?
Thanks, Dan. Our experience with Matterport since we started our enterprise about a year and a half ago was that it provided a very easy to use and high quality platform on which to do numerous things. A lot of those things though were originally designed to be done at small scale, thinking of normal real estate usage. And Matter tags we thought were a very good solution to pointing out features within a house for sale. We took a slightly different angle on the use of Matterport and use it for condition inspections, quality inspections, uses that would see you have not three or four Matter tags in a Matterport digital twin. You might have 50 or 100 or even hundreds of these. However, the problem is using the standard Matterport interface is that you need to manually create these one by one. So we, given that the models we were creating were very popular and people were liking the functionality, we set down a path to automate.
So even before we talk about the automation, when might I have 100 Matter tags, 200 Matter tags?
So a couple of examples starting at maybe a slightly smaller level. Our condition inspection service that we do, we use the Matter tags for two purposes. One is a 3D walkthrough only shows you what the camera can see. It doesn't show you the inside of the oven. It doesn't show you behind the curtains. And those are useful things to capture if it's a condition inspection or a high coverage scenario. So by the time you go through an average house and take photos of all those areas, you might find you've got 30 to 40 Matter tags. And the great thing once you've done that is now you've got a complete coverage of that property rather than just what's shown in the 3D. If I scale that up just a little bit more, the next use case is to then use those Matter tags to point out any condition problems, any flaws, traffic light type system. This is green, this is orange, this is red, any scratches in the walls. So that might lift you from having 30 to 40 Matter tags to having 50 to 70 to 100 Matter tags in a normal sized house. And we have found that that's a very popular use of the Matterport model, being used for a condition inspection prior to a tenant taking over. If we jump up again, we now start talking about virtual online stores, customers who want to be able to walk down the actual aisle of the store, click on a button that brings up a product and have it take them to a shopping cart. Now, that has not been widely implemented at the moment using base Matterport functionality because, of course, the only way to update your products and your prices is to manually edit every Matter tag on the way through. Whereas using our service, we can now hold that information offline and re-import it as it needs to be updated. I'll throw one third one at you, and this is getting into the bigger stuff. We've got construction based scans or digital twins that have over 500 scan positions, up to 800 scan positions. we use the meta tags for wayfinding. So we drop a tag in each room and then we use MP Embed to search on those so you can quickly jump to the room that you want. And of course, you may have seen previously our digital or virtual cemetery that we did, which uses meta tags to pinpoint the location of every gravesite and includes a photo of each headstone and makes it searchable again through MP Embed.
So you've talked about a lot of use cases. I think I heard construction documentation in there too.
Yes.
Facilities management.
Yes.
Products for sale. And, you know, I think when you mention that and you talk about hundreds of products for sale, I would imagine if you're thinking about adding Matterport Matter tags, if you're thinking about adding 100 or more, if you're thinking about adding 10 or more Matterport Matter tags, I think of a very manual operation.
Yes, certainly. So if I'll come back to construction, but maybe just talking about the shopping cart type scenario, I'm probably telling people what they know, but the way an online store works is that you have a storefront that is easy for a user to work with. And sitting in behind it, you have a database that has all the products, their images, their prices, their descriptions. And through the magic of computers, it connects the two so that when a user clicks on a certain selection or searches, they're able to add that to their shopping cart. Now that same theory can apply to a Matterport digital twin now. So the front end becomes the virtual tour. And then we are able to hold a database in the background and use it to update the tags. There are also methods using the SDK to make that on demand. Our service locks it into the meta tags and you update it on a frequent or repeated basis. It really is starting to open the door.
Excuse me, Scott, this is using the Matterport SDK to help automate dynamic pricing.
Yes, so the SDK is a brilliant tool. We use it. We have some custom developments using it. However, it's not accessible to the average Matterport customer. So there are certainly better ways to fully integrate using SDK. What we're doing is using the base Matterport viewer functionality and the meta tag functionality and linking it to a new service that means you can use it on a wider number of use cases that you wouldn't have thought of before.
So would the Matterport Matter tags URL link to a specific place within a shopping cart?
Yeah, I can show you a live example of that if you like.
I would. While you're calling that up, earlier today I was talking with a Matterport service provider in the United States. And he is in the midst of having a discussion with some big box retailers where the anticipation is having a need to upload 900 Matter tags. And this is not even just for one store, this is for multiple locations in the United States. And he's scratching his head, you know, trying to figure out, is this doable? Is it practical? Is it something that he can even price out? Because he's thinking about, wow, 900 Matter tags. This is really a very laborious and tedious process. It's a great tool. But when you start talking about big numbers, it almost becomes impossible to think yes. about from an operational standpoint of how one might manually add 900 Matter tags. So, I said, hey, you might want to tune into our show today, WGAM TV Live at 5. Our guest will talk about automating the importing and exporting of Matter tags. And I would likely imagine that includes connecting it to the shopping cart so that if you want to have a store and literally put a tag on every product that's available for sale, that process is not going to be as hard as he might have thought about when originally trying to price out his project. And I said, hey, if you thought about pricing out your project and you've already accounted for all your labor, oh, by the way, here's a way that you could do this to save yourself a lot of time and effort. So that's the filter that I'm looking through right now when you show me what you're about to show me related to MatterTax meets shopping.
Sure, we'll do. And this is not a live example, it's just a demo environment. So please excuse that it's relatively casual in some of the things that it's showing. I'll just bring that screen up. Just checking that's on your screen now.
Yes, thank you.
So we're actually looking here at the home plan office that we work out of. It's been under lockdown for a month now, so I hope it still looks like that today. We've actually trialed this in a supermarket-based walkthrough, but it's just not ready to show yet. But this will show you the theory. In this particular walkthrough, which was done very quickly for test purposes, you'll see that we've created a room label that is the equivalent of an aisle. And then we've gone ahead and imported a set of data. And you can see down the middle of the room here, we've got these tags. Now, we can determine how long the stems are. We can determine where they go in the model. We could even play with the colors. In fact, you'll see here, we've got some tags that are black and that are white, which you can't actually do in Matterport. You can only have their standard 16 colors. And then each tag itself, using the standard tag functionality, it has a title, it has a description that can include URL links, and it has an image associated with it. So here we are looking at a Huggies product that has a price, it has a description, it even has a link if you want to jump into the online store to look at other diapers and training pants. And of course, if it is the product that we're looking for, we can click it and take it through to a online store or shopping cart, which you may not be able to see through the screen share. Now, if I look down that line, you'll see this is just a test setup. You'll see we've got bananas and we've got ribs and we've got all the great things in life, especially the New Zealand cheese that we can have there. And we've just repeated that test so people can see the functionality. So if you could imagine that this particular model was a supermarket digital twin, then we would be dropping these tags into the middle of the aisle. And then the only piece of manual work required is to drag and drop those tags to their final position, which is a very quick and easy process once you're used to doing it.
Okay, well, so this might be a good point to say, well, how did those tags get there?
Yeah, I'll jump over to a different screen. Excuse me for my own technical incompetence if this takes a moment to do.
Yeah, you're doing great. So I should mention that while you're getting set up, that you took us through a Matter tag that included a label, description, color, the media URL, the anchor, the stem details, which I think also included the color of the top of the Matter tag.
Yeah, correct. So when you edit Matter tags, it gives you a number of things that you can define, the color, the length of the stem, the description. What's on the screen now, if that has come through, is I've just opened up in Microsoft Excel. This is the data that sits behind the tags. And through our service, we're able to export this data out of an existing model, or we can create it from scratch to load into a model for the first time. This particular data set does not have any existing anchor positions. So if we were taking data out of a model, this would actually tell you a coordinate for where those meta tags came from, which is important if you're reloading tags back in. It has a almost nonsensical code that represents the color that maps through to different colors using RGB palettes. Then we have the stuff that you see. Sorry, I'll just try and move across. So you have the description of a meta tag, and it looks a little bit technical, but there's different ways within a description to have a URL link to a shopping cart or to other items, to a PDF or all those things. You have the title of that tag, and then you have the link of that through to a particular online media, if you're linking it to a photo or to a video. We also get to choose the length of the stem, which I don't know about other users. We really hate the stem length little slider you have to use. This solves that. We just set it to a preset, and it will go in at that length and stay there when you drag it around. And then we have a way of mapping our tags to different room labels, so you can import it to one room or the other as you come in.
Cool. So I imagine that if I'm uploading for the first time, you provide some template to say, hey, here's the template, put your data in this Excel sheet for the purpose of being able to import the data.
Yes, absolutely. So the two primary use cases there are that someone wants to take tags out of one model and put them into another version of that same model. So in that case, we can export the data, which gives you the format, and it can be adjusted, and then we can re-upload it.
What would be the use case of why I have two identical Matterport spaces, one of which already has Matter tags and the other one that doesn't? When would I want to move Matterport Matter tags from one Matterport space to another?
Good question. So a couple of different scenarios, which some are easy and some are hard. The easy scenario is when a model has been uploaded once and then it's had to be uploaded a second time. Now that might be because there was a trimming error in it. There was some other navigation problem that made you go back and say, actually, I just need to make an adjustment on the iPad and now upload it a second time. The same applies, and there's been quite a lot of chat on your forum previously about this, is that the Matterport engine gets better over time. And if you captured something a year ago and submitted it a year ago versus submitting it now, you'll actually get a better result now. So it allows you to go back to those old models and resubmit them. Now, in all those scenarios, you probably spent minutes, days, hours, whatever, doing post-production on that original model, and you want to try and carry those settings forward into the new model.
And we're talking specifically about Matterport Matter tags and maybe labels. Labels you can export. I'm not sure you can import the labels.
We can export labels, we can't import them, but it's not actually a hard thing. In the pipeline, we're looking at things like full replication of all settings from one model to another.
Ah, okay.
One day.
Because I'm thinking about that pain point. I worked on a museum. I've tricked it out. I put in all my Matter tags. I got labels on, since they're different, I'll say I have Matter tags on every display case in the museum, on every painting. Yes. I have a complete description. I've worked with my client. And now my client has said, great, I'm going to take it to my boss. And the boss says, hey, can I see that spray or whatever you call it outside the front door? Can you get rid of that? And now I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I have to reprocess my model and manually move every one of those tags. So my pain just went away because I can have home plans, Matter tag solution, export the tags and import them into that virtually identical model.
Correct.
And are the Matter tags going to end up in exactly the same place?
I mentioned before, there's a bit of a catch. So if you have the same base model and in effect, it's a duplicate of it, the tags will generally go to the exact same place. However, a phrase I've started to use is that Matterport will be what Matterport will be. And at times it will decide to change its underlying coordinates just slightly. In 99% of the cases so far, if it's the same model, they will go back to the exact same place. Now, I mentioned before a related use case, which is probably more common, which is where you go back to the same property and scan it a second time. So construction, you might be there scanning it at different stages of fit out or pre-fit out and post-fit out. Now, it is still possible to export the tags from an earlier model and then load it into a later model. But there's a good chance that it will all be offset slightly off to one side. It'll still have the same dimensional relationships between the tags, but they might just all be sitting off to the side a little bit. And that again is Matterport being what Matterport will be. So in those cases, we can then go through, we just work out what the delta is and do some adjustments there to pull those positions back. Okay. So that's delta meaning more common one.
Delta meaning the change of everything moved over an inch. So now that we know that, we can adjust for that.
Correct. It's more likely to be 3 or 4 feet. But yes, exactly that. Once we know, because it keeps the relationship of the tags to each other the same, then you can just change the offset on the entire set for it.
Okay. So what would be a reason in, let's say, weekly construction documentation where matter tags were used, I would imagine, to communicate to the various trades to say, okay, we got heating and plumbing questions, we got electrical questions, we have mechanical questions. The next week, that same space was reshot again. Is there a reason to bring forward all those matter tags?
Well, certainly that's up to the users to define, but what we're trying to align here is that it's similar to a one-to-many type relationship. You might have one Matterport scan, and related to that, you've got tags that want to change over time, or you might have the opposite. You might have multiple Matterport scans of a property that you want to relate to one static set of matter tags over time and every iteration between. So in that construction example, they might simply want to use the matter tags for wayfinding so that every room has a tag on it, and using MP Embed and its search features, so they can type in a room number or code and be taken straight to that room, regardless of which model they are looking at. If you flip it the other way, it might be that the tags were used to highlight issues, and I can show you an example of that on a residential scale if you like.
Sure, let's take a look at that. Yeah. While you're calling that up, I guess what I was thinking about on the construction documentation is that perhaps one model is sent off to the electrical team, one model sent off to the plumbing team, one model is sent off to the safety team, one model in, and so everybody may be identifying different issues, but I imagine the leadership team wants to see all those, and they might want to see them all together in one model. So would that be an example of a use case is to say, oh,
sure,
each of these different trades, mechanical, electrical, plumbing, all MEP, all put down their issues, but now, the pain and suffering, the thought of moving 50 tags from one model to 50 from here, 50 from here, and 50 from here to get to the 150 so that the executives can see all the problems and issues at the same time. That just seems like too big a pain point that for anyone to manually deal with that, either by time or the expense of that time to do that. So you actually have a solution that maybe creates even a new use case for Matterport weekly construction documentation by enabling the model, a different version of the exact same model, to go to different constituencies to do their piece of the puzzle, then have it come back to the whoever is managing the project, that maybe the general contractor, maybe the photographer for the general contractor.
Yes, I wouldn't want to push the default Matterport functionality as the replacement for a proper defect management system. It's just not complicated enough for that. Certainly with the SDK, there's the ability to create that in future. What this allows you to do is, rather than when you get to that point of deciding you want to present what you know, it used to be, oh my God, I've got to create these things manually, and therefore they would discount it as an option. Now what they can do is assemble their data in a preset format and load them through. So the time it takes us to create 100, 200 tags is probably the time it would take a normal person to create 10 tags. So it opens up a new use case. In the scenario that you're outlining, it might be you've got 3 or 4 contractors are either using a defect management system or multiple defect management systems. They've got the data collected, but it's not shown in 3D. What our service allows them to do is then stockpile it into one place and load it in once, and then view it through the 3D model.
So I'm. This is like way over my head in terms of subject matter expertise, but it sounds like someone's collecting a lot of data. I'm guessing that if it's not in an Excel spreadsheet, it's in a database, a relational data. If it's not in a flat file, it's in a relational database. If it's in a relational database, it probably means it's possible to export it to a flat file like we think of Excel. And then if you can get to Excel, then you have a way to then import using the home plan Matterport, Matter Tag engine, a way to now bring data into a three-dimensional world.
You've got it right.
I'm literally tingling because as soon as I went through that workflow, I'm going, wow, this is pretty crazy and exciting because it's disruptive in a really exciting way for a general contractor where the project's large enough that there are, what did you call it? A construction, what's the term for this?
The defect management system.
For the defect management system, the data exists someplace, but I'm such a visual person. Boy, would I just love to see that within the three-dimensional model as opposed to within an Excel spreadsheet as a punch list. So this sounds like it's transformational in a disruptive good way to enable possibilities that maybe people haven't thought about except you.
I'll give you a live example, then I'll show you the result of it. This is what we do internally that actually led to us developing this service or these tools. We use a inspection tool called iAuditor. Now that's a very common tool worldwide. It's very easy to configure, very flexible. And in that tool, when we go to a site to do condition inspections, we first of all scan it using the Matterport camera. We then go around it with our iPad and the iAuditor app, and we will say whether the room is in good condition or not. We'll take photos of specific condition issues. We'll take photos of inside the oven, behind the curtains, all those things. Now, iAuditor saves that information into its database. That database can be accessed by API, or it can just be exported as a flat file, as a CSV. Now, we've now got a transformation built that allows us to take that data as it's stored in iAuditor and reformat it into the CSV format that is needed for the tag import tool. So it used to take us an hour on site to capture the information and then an hour to 2 hours off site to recompile the information and create the condition inspection walkthrough. It now takes us an hour on site and it takes us about 15 minutes off site to create the outcome that I'm about to show you.
Awesome, I'd love to see it.
Okay, has WebStreet come up in front of you?
Yes.
Okay, so we're looking now at a space. We use WP3D, a great front-end tool, and we use it to distribute what we do to our clients.
Pause a second. So we're speaking a little bit in shorthand. So for when you say WP3D, we're actually talking about WP3D Models WordPress plugin, and that's what you're using to create this page that we're looking at that includes both, that includes the Matterport digital twin. There was some text information, a map, photos. It looks like a floor plan or site plan below that. Great. So this is actually what you're showing is home plan an integration using WP3D models for the visual storytelling that you're doing with a client.
Yes, correct. And the most common use case for this particular plugin, WP3D, is to present a public web page of a property for sale or to help advertise it. We use the functionality with a bit of customization to actually use it as a digital property record. So we create a table here and we record whether we have one or multiple walkthroughs for this property, any associated 2D imagery, and the ability to download all of that in one go for our clients. So if I was to click this open button, it would open up the walkthrough in another window or open these others.
And it's going to open up the window for the specific row that you're looking at. So the print's a little bit small. Could you just give us an example of one of those rows and how that access button works?
Yes, sure. So I'm not sure if that zoom in helped at all.
Yes, thank you. But
this is what we're about to look at. It's actually the walkthrough at the top of the screen, so that's a bit easier, but it was captured on the 2nd of March. Its status is active, and if I click on this, it'll open it up in a new window. Then we have the associated files that go with it that we can also open. I'll come back another time, Dan, and talk about this, because this is actually the gateway to our open archive development that's coming. So in time, you'll see that that's archived, and we'll have a way to actually open and provide access to archived Matterport files.
Scott, if you could, excuse me for talking over you, if you could just pause 1 second there. When you showed me this page, I was immediately realized that that was a WP3D Models WordPress plugin created page. That said, where you have your open button, that was the first time that I've seen an interactive button added to WP3D Models. So kudos to you to figure out how you did that to accomplish what you're about to show.
Thank you. Thank you. So moving into the content itself, this is a small property in central Wellington. In this case, we did not do a marketing walkthrough. It was just a condition inspection. And I'll just stand somewhere that you can get the general sense of what we've done. So you see here, we've got meta tags on a relatively wide scale and they are color coded. Purple represents just a feature. For example, we have a very easy floor plan in this case, sitting in that model, which we link in. We then have red for bad, orange for an issue, and green for good. So on this wardrobe, for example, we have incorporated a photo that allows them to see the inside of that photo for inspection purposes. And that achieves a higher level of coverage than just a standard walkthrough would otherwise allow you to see.
So for clarification, Scott, how is the content for these tags created and how did it end up in this model?
That is the end-to-end process that we have built. So I'll just describe it rather than jumping between lots of windows. When we were on site, we did, as all Matterport users would, went here and created a 3D scan. Then when we had finished that, we used the iAuditor tool to go around and capture the content of all of these tags. Then when we get back to the office, we process the model and we link the two together. We export the data from iAuditor, for which we've got an automated job that does it. And then we used our import tool to then load them in. It dropped all the tags down the center of the room. And then our job was to then drop them to their final resting position, which takes about 2 or 3 seconds per tag to do.
So if I took you off screen sharing for a moment there. So Scott, if I'm a Matterport service provider, I'm looking for new opportunities for my scanning to help maybe help differentiate myself from another Matterport service provider. If I kind of can figure out who's doing property inspection, and it sounds like if you're a property management company and you're managing maybe Airbnb rentals, does that sound like an example?
Yes, though Airbnb is probably less popular these days right now.
Okay, so in a normal world, so if I have properties, I'm thinking of I'm a property management company, and maybe people are vacationing for the week. So I have a lot of people that move out on a Saturday, and I have a lot of people that move in on a Sunday. Is that an example where that property, that documentation is going to take place in order to catch any, and maybe I'm using the wrong examples. Maybe it's not a vacation rental apartment. It's a vacation, it's a luxury vacation rental home. And someone is managing lots of those properties at a beach destination. And somebody's coming in with this app, taking a lot of pictures in order to note, is the oven a train wreck? Help me out here. Help me understand this space.
Yes, you're definitely on the right track. But for cost efficiency, it typically applies to long-term rentals. So people who do not own their own homes, who are renting. Now there is a landlord somewhere who owns that property, and there's a handshake agreement that happens at the start. When you move into a rental property, the tenant and the landlord are agreeing what the condition of that property is at that point in time. When that tenant moves out in 6 months, a year, 2 years, they'll then reassess, did you actually cause any damage to this property that you now need to repair before you go on your way? Now that process was, before we entered into this market, was predominantly done through 2D methods, taking hundreds of photos, and the photo they eventually needed was the one they forgot to take. So what we do is take one really big photo using the 3D digital twin. Then we supplement it with 2D photos, so we get as close as possible 100% coverage, and then we point out the things that are relevant for them. And that led us into a very successful launch of our services here in New Zealand, but it did create an overhead, because the work required to create the meta tags to allow that service to work was cumbersome. And that's what opened us into this development pathway, and that's why we share it now with others. So if they want to look at doing this as a service, it gives them a way of making it more efficient for them to use the meta tags.
This is awesome hearing. So as a Matterport service provider in New Zealand, you had this opportunity that involved both Matterport and this documentation, and you realized if you put the two together, 1 + 1 = 100, it didn't equal 1 + 1 = 1. It really was something powerful. And I could also imagine when you did that digital twin, the digital twin could be used to help rent out that long-term rental, even while somebody was living there, because now they've said, hey, we're moving out, and maybe not, you have the benefit of somebody walking into the space. Maybe it's a long-term rental from someone that doesn't even live in New Zealand. So now you have this digital twin to show off the space. And then in parallel, you have a digital twin that has all this documentation that essentially when the long-term renter now says, I'm moving in, there's documentation at that move in of what the condition of the space looked like at that
correct
time.
And you could standardize that. In our examples, we're going issue by issue. You could have one tag per wall or per surface, and then you could actually export, use that as a standard format and export that and re-import it into future copies of that model for that property.
Yeah, this is awesome. I'm so excited visiting with you on this, Scott. I recall sitting down at a conference here in Atlanta with a property management company, not for the vacation, but as you're describing, they rent out homes. And here in Atlanta, that company might be responsible for renting out 300 homes. It never occurred to me that there was somebody that had to document what the condition of that property was for the purpose of when that person moves out, did they materially change the space outside the scope of what that lease agreement was? So that's this field called property documentation?
Yeah, property management, yes.
Property management, property documentation. So where I might have only been thinking of, oh, Matterport, I can help them lease that space. Okay, well, actually, I now have yet a whole nother service that I can be offering is using that app that you're describing, which they're probably already using that app, is to show where the value of overlapping the two together creates this value, presumably, of being able to one, have a record, but two, have the documentation of all the things that need to be fixed before it gets rented out again.
Yeah, absolutely. And
a punch list? Would you call that as a punch list?
In construction, it's a punch list because it's there to be fixed. Often it's just a record of what's wrong. But to lift that conversation up to what this actually means to those who do this for a living, this is just a particular use case that when we started, and if others started it, just using manual meta tag creations, we've done 300 of these in the last 6 months. And if we were not using our own service to automate it alongside iAuditor, to do 300 models and tag them with 50, 100 models in each one of them, you're probably talking between 300, 600, even 800 hours worth of work. With our tools in play now, that's probably 100 hours worth of work.
Yeah, I think
so
what's
it really opens it up.
Yeah, it's probably a couple things going on that run through my mind. First is your tool is actually making it practical, because if you had to bill the 800 hours for something that really should be 100 hours, the project might collapse just on the cost itself, because yes, it's such a labor intensive process. So certainly that's both time and money associated with the time, because somebody's got to bill out that time. But what I'm also hearing when you describe this, again, if I'm a Matterport service provider and I'm looking to differentiate myself, then I got something that others probably don't, because I know about home plan automation for Matterport Matter tags to get it out of that relational database of the app into that CSV file to be able to import into Matterport. And now I have kind of like a secret sauce that I can offer that perhaps somebody else isn't even aware of that solution.
Well, I don't want to get into, because we could have a very long discussion on Matterport scanning services and what that means for the industry. But these are examples where MSPs and others can offer value-add services that differentiate themselves from vanilla delivery of Matterport Digital Twins. And we're just going to be smarter. I mean, there is a market out there for what Matterport is trying to do. I get that. Our job is to be one step ahead of the game. They've given us this platform that can do some wonderful things. Some of those things they are not doing themselves. Our job is to put those in front of customers and attract them to our services.
Yeah, and so I love, you said make it smarter, value add, this is really elevating the value of a Matterport service provider of adding a huge amount of value to that digital twin. If I can go back just for a moment to my conversation earlier today, I'm thinking of those 900 tags, and that was in, I don't want to disclose the category of the space, but there's aisles. So how do you get the tags from a database to have them actually end up in the appropriate aisle so I can then place the tags in the right place within the aisle?
Sure. Shall I show you an example?
Yeah, that would be great.
It's not of it's not actually a supermarket that I'm going to show. We have one under development at the moment that does that, but hopefully you'll get the feeling from this share. So we're actually looking just in a vacated property at the moment that we were using as a bit of a test bed. And if you can't sleep at night, you could always try counting matter tags. There's about 280 in these four aisles. So with the powers of visualization, I'll show you this model. It's an indoor-outdoor scan that we've done. And just zooming in on that space, you can see what we've done here is we've created some room labels, bulk import one, bulk import two, three, and four, and we've dropped them where we want to start the row from. So if this was a supermarket, you'd have your aisles of products down either side of this. Then we create a CSV file that has the data. This is just dummy data in here at the moment with some images and things thrown in. And load it in, and you choose the spacing. So here we chose to import a certain number and that they should be spaced so far apart each with a certain stem length. So the result is once it loads in, we get to see it via the SDK before we commit it. And then we say, yes, it's where we want it to be. Now we could have created these tags all through this building. We could have had some more over in this area had we wanted. We just elected to drop them in these four places for this upload.
So, and then So each of those rows, that again, that might have been produce.
Correct. In this case, we're just showing dummy data and an image. But if I remind you of the earlier example we showed, we actually had in the detail, you had the product information, you had a link to the online store, could all be pre-populated from the CSV file.
So it's really for the Matterport service provider working with their client to say, you know, hey, can you give me your Excel file, your CSV file, so that it's organized. You'll make it easier for all of us if you logically order the Matter tags, whether it's in by aisle for a store, or by section of a store, or however it is that they do their planning grid for that store. I just have to think that they actually have some kind of organized way to, even when they're in an aisle, that there's this section of the aisle, 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 and therefore it shouldn't be that hard to ask them to provide the data in that way.
Correct. And if you follow that thought process, in this case, we've done one import per row, and the definition of a row is taken from the position of the room label tag that we've added, these bulk import ones. If you had an aisle going down the page and halfway down it went from flour to sugar to whatever, they would all be created as room labels, and we could just have the flower tag sitting next to that section. So there's a piece of work to determine what tags need to be dropped where to get them close. Because once you're close, of course, then you can just jump in and click on each one and drag them to the products where they need to go.
So literally we're in Matterport workshop right now. You've imported the tags, you're doing an inspection. You might decide to save and publish them, save them and publish, or you might say, okay, I'm now ready to start dragging the tags, the Matter tags, to put them in the right place, to point to that product.
Correct. So we're now looking at standard Matterport functionality with all the tags, just with default names here at the moment. But if this here was the aisle of the products, it's as simple now as clicking each one and just finding the right image to associate it to, and then drop them where we need to drop them. So that is the manual piece of work that is still required, is to do that final positioning. But of course, once I've done this, I can then re-export the data, and now I have that coordinate stored. So the next time we upload the data, we don't repeat this process. They'll already be in these positions where we've put them.
But I think if I heard you correctly earlier, we're really talking about a URL that's pointing to a shopping cart. So we're not manually going into the model to change the prices of each produce within a tag manually. You have Home Plan has actually automated the shopping cart Home Plan has automated going from shopping cart to Matter tag, so that if there's dynamic pricing, the pricing's changing within the Matterport space without somebody to have to go in and manually change the Matter tags.
Correct. So to put it into three logical buckets, this line you can see here is the data that's been imported and dropped, ready for the customer, our customer, to drop it where it needs to go. Then once they do this and they drop it where they want it to go, we re-export that, and that becomes our new data set, because that's where you want them to stay long term. And the third layer is now the data within each one of these tags. That is what can now be dynamically updated. We just update the file and re-import them, and these will have their new descriptions, new prices, new links, new photos, whatever it needs to be.
I'm confused. I don't actually need to re-import them to have the price change, because the link is actually pointing to a dynamic link within the shopping cart.
Without going too deep into it, once we create a tag, if this here happened to have a shopping cart URL in here, as you can add using the standard functionality, that is a static link. The content it might point to could be quite dynamic and could change over time. If you want to just include the link, then you would never need to change this tag again, because it links the online store. If you want the tag to include the price and a description and how many are available, all that data changes over time. So that would require us to re-upload that data in. At the moment, what we do is we re-import the tags fresh. It has the same effect as if you were going in and updating the data, because it puts them back in the same place again.
So I imagine if a company came to you and said, hey, we want to do this at scale, and we have things that change in price, and we really do want to have the daily price, the prices change daily, the inventory change daily, while that piece might be a manual export-import, I imagine if the project's big enough, you'll figure out how to automate the process.
Yes, if you were going to a daily or even a real-time update, there's other ways to do that using transient meta tags. I would suggest our solution at the moment is best suited to weekly updates, monthly updates, less frequent. So a good example that actually came out, we've been approached by a furniture shop, and that furniture shop has 300 items in there. They don't change that often, but they do sell them and then run out of them. So they might do an update to that information once every 3 weeks or something like that, in which case a manual process works just fine. But it is absolutely possible. What we're doing is unlocking.
Well, I should say a manual process works just fine. That's using your automated tool to automate that manual process. So what for 300 Matter tags to change that out weekly, for a Matterport service provider thinking in a traditional manner, that would be a nightmare. But using the home plan automation tool for exporting and importing, it makes it super easy, super fast, and affordable to do. But there is still presently a manual piece that you do in the background to facilitate that.
Yeah, what actually absolutely amazes me, Dan, is as we've been approached by different people about this service, the things they're asking me about, I never would have thought you would use Matterport for, and the effort that people are going to in museums, exhibitions, construction, condition inspections. It's very laborious the way they've done it. They're trying to do exactly as we did. They're trying to differentiate themselves, use the tool to best effect, and use that to get the most out of it, and possibly promote their services over others. I'm just amazed at all these applications that are appearing. Now, what we've done so far, think of it as a version one release of what we're doing. We've unlocked it. We know that we can load literally thousands of meta tags if the model could take it, and do it in a way that would take a fraction of the time of a manual process. There will be future iterations, the ability to directly update tags, the ability to have transient tags that you can update in real time. All those things are possible, and we might look at further on as new versions of what we do.
Scott, you mentioned the app earlier in the property management, the popular, forgive me, I didn't write it down, the app.
The Open Archive?
No, the app for documenting.
iAuditor.
iAuditor. Yes. And are you automating a process right now for how you get from iAuditor to a spreadsheet to upload to the Matterport tour?
So we have built a automation of that process that currently has two manual steps still in it. And once we are comfortable that those automated steps work, we can then move to full automation from iAuditor into the Matterport models.
Great. And so as you keep coming across documentation tools, then if the project warrants, you'll write the automation to help facilitate this so that it you keep reducing the number of steps, reducing the amount of time to actually facilitate doing this on a weekly basis if that's what the client needs.
Correct. What we've proven is that it's possible, and we're our own best use case because we are using iAuditor with automated steps, and something that used to take us hours now takes us minutes. So that encourages us to take what we've put out to market right now, which is the tag import service, and look at expanding that in future so others can enjoy the end-to-end automation that we've managed to create for ourselves.
Okay, you mentioned earlier MP Embed. M is in Mary, P is in Paul, MP Embed, a overlay for Matterport Showcase that you had done something interesting and innovative with that particular third-party tool, which turns out to be very popular among the We Get Around Network forum community. Can you describe in a little deeper dive when and how you use MP Embed?
Yeah, absolutely. Do you want me to jump quickly into a model again to show
sure.
that?
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
I've got two examples. I'll jump first back into the one we were already looking at, the Web Street property. We wouldn't be without MP Embed. It makes all this possible. Again, those who are familiar with Matter tags in Matterport know that there isn't a great deal you can do with them apart from enter the data and then drop them around. We have over the side here, this is from the MP Embed tool. A couple of cool tools we've got that that Chris provides us through MP Embed. We can just turn all the meta tags off, which is quite useful.
Excuse me, you mentioned Chris. So that's MP Embed developer Chris Hickman.
Yes. So he has this ability to be able to just switch tags on and off, which we love because it does clutter up the screen a lot. His other facility that is good in this use case is the ability to take a snapshot of the screen, allowing that within the front end rather than having to be a workshop user to do so. But the real benefit comes up here. This is MP Embed functionality you're looking at here, where you can create filters automatically based on color. So we can just jump to all the issues in this case, which are red, and be taken straight to that particular tag. Or we can search, and I don't know what to search for, but we'll try curtain or something. And it will jump you to the tags that have that particular word in it. The final use that we have here is just the ability to group. So here you can see that even though it's quite a small apartment, there's quite a few tags in it. So our ability to have a very simple logical flow of the different tags by room so that you can look at these things is very valuable.
So could you show turning on and off different tags based on using MP Embed, that panel on the left?
So using this panel on the left, you can search for a particular item. You can filter to get down to them and select the ones that you want. And of course, if you just want them all to disappear, there's this button down in the corner which just makes everything go away.
Okay, so let's turn on all the tags for the moment, Matter tags. Okay, and now you mentioned that red was a problem, so maybe you could select red.
Yes.
And but I still see tags displayed. So mm-hmm. is it still going to display all the tags, but I can see on the left panel which ones are red?
Correct. So this is a filtering of which of the tags meet the criteria that you've entered. So you can then select them. It doesn't make the other ones disappear. It just helps you navigate very quickly to the one that you're looking for.
Ah, okay. So let's turn, if you would, let's turn them all on. And then I see kitchen cutlery draw dirty. Yes. So if you click on that, now it's highlighted that matter tag and it showed us a photo within that tag showing that, so that's a still photo that was taken with your app, automatically exported from the app, imported into using HomePlan, imported into the Matterport workshop, placed in the right place. Now using MP embed, you could go literally find that dirty, where is that dirty drawer in the Matterport space?
Correct.
Wow, this kind of like blows me away. I think it's probably like what you described. You had a problem for specific clients. You built this tool to solve the problem. But now as you start rolling it out in the We Get Around Network Forum community, it sounds like you're starting to learn about other use cases that you hadn't even occurred to you.
Yes, correct.
It's awesome. Can we go back? I really want to go back to MP embed because this is a super powerful tool. And
Do you want me to jump into the other example, Dan?
Yes, but not yet. I still want to go back to the example you were showing us, okay. Scott.
That's fine. You're the boss, Dan.
You're the man.
Here we go.
Okay. So I really want to go slowly on this left panel. So the different colors, tell us within MPMB what these are called. These are...
So the colors are what you can do in MP embed. Well, if I jump back a step, when you're creating tags in Matterport or through our tool, you're choosing a color that you want the head of that meta tag to be. What you can then do in MP embed, there's an option to map a label to every color combination, the 16 ones that are available within Matterport. So we've simply told it that if it's a green tag in Matterport, that means good or clean in MP embed. And that allows us to then create a grouping based on that color.
Awesome. And those are they called labels or would you call it something else?
They're just in terms of I can't remember the exact term that is in MP embed for them, but let's call them labels.
Okay, so we'll call them labels. And then you could put those labels in whatever order you wanted on that menu. It sounds like you could have as many as 16 of those labels because there's 16 default Matterport colors.
I assume so. We tend to try and keep it down to a traffic light type system where we have and a couple of other ones like exclusion.
Okay. And then where did the different room types come from?
So that is at this stage a manual activity within MP embed, as you have the ability when you have this tags window come up in MP embed, you can create folders basically, and within those folders you can then drop the tags into. At the moment, that has a manual process.
That's what I was going for. So presently, yeah. there's a manual step in saying take the pins that are related to no, because the bathroom would in the example you gave earlier, the bathroom would be a row. So you already have the matter tags assigned to bathroom.
Correct. I'm sure that again in future versions there's no reason with a bit of collaboration between us and Chris, that because we know that this tag belongs to a bathroom group, it would just then be creating an interface to allow MPMBed to know and to accept that data. But again, this is not a big job. Once you have all these tags appearing to create these set of folders, it'll take about 2 minutes to drag and drop them into the right place.
Oh, okay, great. And then if we go right down to the bottom, you were showing just two other buttons from MPMB. One button was related to turn on and off Matter tags. The other button right to the right of that was the camera. So if you needed a snapshot showing a particular place in the room, and I'm going to guess if you opened up a Matter tag and you displayed that dirty drawer, kitchen drawer, then you could take a snapshot of the room with that Matter tag of the dirty drawer open. Is that correct?
The standard function there for that photograph would be, for example, when you see this big scratch on the wall, would be to take a shot of that and export it as a standard image. Whether there's value in snapshotting the tag itself, I don't know, because we already have this as a saved image for this particular property.
Okay, so. If you were trying to call attention to where the problem was and you wanted to, you might take an overall picture and that Matter tag might be open. I think the point is that screen capture would capture the Matter tag open if that's what you chose to do.
I believe so. I need to do some testing around it. The problem we have in New Zealand is that the judicial system doesn't work in 3D yet. So that if you were having an argument about the condition of this property and whether this existed before or after, all they will accept is photos and printouts of photos to discuss it.
But the good news is it's actually in a logical way that if you know you don't have to go scour to go find all your stuff. It really is organized in a way that makes it super. I mean, you know, if that was a relational database that had 200 different line items, you got to go. I'm a visual person. This just seems to be so much easier to look at this visually and decide what piece you need. Scott, you had another example you wanted to show us?
It's one that we've shared before, but again, it's one of those use cases that people might not think about until you put it in front of them. So this here, again, I'm using the same WP3D plugin at the front end, but this time, this is a indoor-outdoor scan of a cemetery. Now, this is a very historic building we have here in Wellington, a small church. The original scope, when we first discussed it with them, was purely to do a 3D walkthrough of this church area. But then we got to thinking and we pulled the BLK 360 camera out and said, hey, why don't we do the entire cemetery, the entire graveyard, and let's not just scan it, let's have the ability to have on every headstone details of who is buried there and a close-up photo of that particular headstone. And then we thought, well, in addition to doing that, then why not use MPMBed and have the ability to search for a certain person and have it take you straight to that particular place in the cemetery.
Wow.
So this particular model draws together lots of things that sort of we do that are a bit different to how other people work. So this is a full outdoor scan using a combination of the BLK 360 camera and the Matterport Pro 2 camera. And then we have within it about 300 meta tags, which of course links back to our import service. These originally would have been dropped down these rows to be close to where they need to be positioned. And then we've gone and manually dropped them in position to get their final, excuse the pun, resting point.
Is this a pro-social project that we're looking at?
Yeah. We basically did this as much as anything for our own research and development in terms of compared to being a commercial type job. And it's been met with a lot of positive feedback. The ability to have virtual cemeteries. There's already search capability online, but they don't give you this sort of first person ability to, as if you were there, walk and visit the gravesite of a relative, which might be in another country or another time.
Yeah, you know what I that's great. Thanks for showing us that example, Scott. You know, I think one of the great things about looking at that example, first you mashed up so many different things: Matterport Pro 2 3D camera, Leica BLK 360 camera, obviously Matterport Matter tags, the home plan. Importing of the Matter tags, that project obviously would not have been possible to manually do. The use of WP3D models, WordPress plugin, and the use, I've run out of fingers, the use of MP embed. And when you mashed up all those different solutions that you were able to create something that is super easy and to use. I think it's a good example for two reasons. One, not that it's necessarily something that you're going to be making money with. Yes, it's pro-social. You gifted this church something, you know, beautiful that is meaningful to a lot of people and families to kind of bring that space to life. But I think by doing those kinds of passion projects, you discover, you know, problems, and then all of a sudden you're able to solve a problem with the tool. But once you look at something like this, I'm going to suggest two things. One is for our audience to look at that and say, okay, don't think about it as a cemetery. Think about it as, where else are there spaces that need lots of documentation that simply wouldn't have been possible without the home plan automation of exporting and importing Matter tags. And the second thing is, I'm going to say something. I don't know if it's true or not, and maybe it's too soon, but I imagine that when you do a pro-social project, a passion project like documenting the church, there are so many people that your project now touches from as they use that tool to go find their loved ones or to share with people, that at some point somebody's going to say, wow, I got a factory. Can you help me with that? I got property that needs to be documented. Can you help me with that? So I think over time that this probably will generate inbound leads from people that look at it and have a use for it in business that reach out to you. I may be reading in too much, but I think that will happen.
No, I think you're right. Just returning to the charitable approach, if you can find one more finger there, the next potential step, which we may or may not do for this project, is to now put it into our pay-per-view overlay. It works within our pay-per-view, which means that church can now use it to raise funds.
So that's an entire topic, home plan pay-per-view, and we're going to have Scott, hopefully Scott, you'll come back and tell us about your new home plan pay-per-view solution.
Yes.
We'll set up a date on that.
Yeah. Yes, I thought I'd mention it there because I think that the use of 3D tours in for charitable reasons is a missed opportunity. With so many of us stuck at home and needing to spend more time at home while COVID-19 is haunting us, this gives the opportunity for MSPs to go out and create 3D tours, enrich them so that they are a real experience like this graveyard tour is, and then add an overlay that allows them to monetize it, which means those charitable organizations can begin raising funds. I mean, I don't know, Dan, but I'm guessing that anyone who's connected to that cemetery wouldn't mind paying a few dollars for the ability to walk its grounds and search for search for the gravestones of their family members. So I certainly think that there is, I won't try and push pay-per-view in this discussion, but it is a useful use case to think about. But you're right, all we're doing at the moment is throwing some use cases that you and I know about or can think about. With so many Matterport MSPs or users out there, they're all using this in slightly different ways that we didn't imagine. So all we're doing is putting this on the table and say, hey, if you were being held back by MatterTags being a manual creation process, well, we can help you with that.
Yeah, I see the in two use cases. One is these are pain points that I have today because I had to re-upload the model and I now need to move matter tags from here to there, and I really don't want to do that all over again. Use cases that without this automation simply are not practical, either from the pain and suffering of having to manually do so many matter tags, or the cost that one would need to charge a client in order to do it would simply be prohibitive. So I think it's use cases that we have pain today that you solve, but you also have use cases for opportunities that your tool now enables. And I think that's really probably exciting for both of us, because I'm really curious of what are all the different use cases that may surface once someone realizes that this automation is possible.
We certainly know that we now have an MSP who is working on scanning a small scale supermarket with the intention of using it as a online store. And because the nature of that is public, you'll get to see the result of that once it's been completed. And we're absolutely inviting and approaching others. When we find a model online that has 100, 200 tags, we're reaching out to those MSPs and saying, hey, that's really cool. Just so you know, because I know how you created those tags, if you need to get the data out again, if you need to do it again or update them, we're here, we can help with that.
Awesome. I hope when that supermarket is a public space that you'll encourage the Matterport service provider to publish it to the We Get Around Network forum. For those that are watching on YouTube or Vimeo or one of a dozen other places where our show shows up, wegetaroundnetworkforum.com, wegetaroundnetworkforum.com. No hyphens, just wegetaroundnetworkforum.com, or the short version, wganforum.com. Scott, we didn't talk about exporting Matterport labels. Do you have an example to show, or can you talk about when someone might want to export Matterport labels?
Sure. So we have the ability to export labels, and the primary use of that is actually to ensure that we get the right connection of imported tags to the right label. I'm not aware, though I'm sure other users of Matterport will correct me, of a very strong case to have hundreds of labels in a model. So it is something that we can do. We can export them out, but it's pretty much a supplement to the MatterTag import and export process.
So an example might be, let's say in that grocery store, I might literally go through the grocery store and put row one, row two, row three, row four, row five, row six, that might be a label. And then I might have row 1A, row 1B, one row C, one row D, one row F. And now I've created some, what would you call that? Organization, a process to say, okay, I have 20,000 square feet, however many meters that is. I'm about to go import 200 matter tags. I want to be able to put the matter tags as close as possible to the pasta section, to the water section, to the yogurt section. So I'll go through the model the first time. I'll go map it with labels. And then I'll ask you to export all those labels so I don't have to hand write them. And now I have the labels to actually map to the matter tags in some form or fashion within, let's say, Excel. Okay. So anything else on Matterport label export?
No, I'll just maybe point to the, on our website, we've got a video there. It takes you through the whole process, showing you the actual back end that we use. And that will help you understand a bit more as to where we use or the connection between labels and meta tags.
Great. Scott, how about taking us to that page so that our viewers know where to find that video? I've watched the video, and I think it's 8 or 9 minutes. It's really excellent. It really gets into a little bit deeper dive of, there it is. So we're on the website, homeplan.nz, HOMEPLAN.NZ. What do you call that in New Zealand? What do you call a Z?
Zed, the way Zed. It should be said.
Okay, homeplan.nz for our New Zealand viewers. And then up at the top, it says global, new. And so that is where you clicked on that. Then you got down to Matterport import for tags. And that's the page that we're on. Then we can see this video in the top right corner there. That video kind of walks you through the process of downloading, uploading, in a little bit greater detail than we've showed today. But the video is so excellent, I didn't think we actually needed to go through in that level of detail. Scott, how about scrolling down, if you would? Let's take a look at pricing and walk us through pricing of home plan automation of exporting and importing of Matterport matter tags.
Absolutely. You'll notice from the pricing that the service is designed for those working at scale. So if you have only 10 matter tags, then it's probably works out cheaper, more efficient just to do them yourself. But we're dealing with models that have 50, 100, hundreds of tags. So the pricing structure that we've got here is, if you have a model that has the tags in it, you've manually created them previously, and you want to export them out into a CSV format, we can do that for you for a one-off charge of $20. If you move over to the next service, which is to import, we will export them for free. It's part of the next service along. And for us to import tags, it works out to be 50 cents per tag, starting at a minimum of 100. So $50 is the minimum charge there. Now, that those prices assume that there is data that's ready, and we're working with others now. For example, sometimes it takes a few additional steps to prepare the data, and we're happy to help out with that as well. Ultimately here, we're here to help. We're Matterport geeks. And I think I mentioned before, I've been blown away. All of the applications of Matterport that have come through advertising this service, our pay-per-view service, I never dreamed how wide it could be used. So we're really keen to make connections. And for anyone who wants to use this type of service ongoing, we'll make it work. We'll make it cost effective.
Terrific. Take me to one level of detail. Do I have to transfer my model to home plan to actually have this process work?
Yes, we've got some constraints based on the Matterport API, and there are some enhancements coming to that API later this year, which will help. In today's world, for us to be able to import tags into the model, the easiest way is that model is transferred to our account. We then run the scripts, update it, and then transfer it back to the customer.
Awesome. Scott, is there anything, what question should I ask you that I haven't asked about home plan automation of Matterport matter tags?
Dan, I think you're the most thorough interviewer I've ever had to deal with. So well done. I think you've thoroughly covered the topic and made me think about a few things along the way. What I would suggest is there will always be people who ask, how exactly does it work? And look to the video in the first instance, but I'm happy to jump on Zoom meetings with other customers if they want to understand it better, understand their applications. And of course, we like to give it a go. If we're not sure it's the right application, well, then let us know what the model is. I mentioned before the Matterport API and that the models need to be transferred to us to upload them. We actually don't need the model transferred to us to export from them. So we can actually do a bit of a proof of concept on people's models with it still sitting in their account to show them what the data looks like and how it works.
Okay, very cool. This is very exciting to see how you've taken the Matterport API SDK and added a huge value to the Matterport ecosystem. So super exciting. Scott, before we say bye, anything else you want to cover, talk about?
I want to say, first of all, thank you, Dan, for spending the best part of an hour and a half talking to us about this. It's been great. Our desire to move our service globally was brought about by the COVID-19 being in lockdown. Our normal day job, if you like, is scanning properties. We have 4 Pro 2 cameras. We have a BLK, we have a Z1, but we were building our own automation tools for our own purposes. And when we all went into lockdown, that was our opportunity to take what we had known and allow others to leverage it as well. So the MatterTag import-export, that's been about 6 months in development, and we're glad to now have it launched. We touched on before the pay-per-view. That, again, we believe is a useful feature in the world going forward, the ability to charge an entry fee on a Matterport model that's been enriched to make it a good experience, be it for charitable fundraising or for exhibitions and the like. And then we've got the big one coming along soon as well, which I'm happy to share just a couple of details of. We've got a service coming called Open Archive. There's been a relatively high amount of heartache out there about Matterport's change last year from classic pricing to the more active pricing and the fact that it can be 10 times more expensive. We have approval from Matterport for what we're doing, and we're developing a similar front end to our pay-per-view that allows a customer to have inactive or archived models sitting, and we're able to grant access to them to make them active for a very limited amount of time and then close them down again. And what that means is if you have 1,000 Matterport models that all need to be active, maybe for insurance, for the occasional use, rather than that requiring a license that has to have 1,000 active models available to it, you could probably do it with 50 active models. So it's a really exciting product. It's the one we've been actually working on the longest. It's there to help us because we're in the same boat as everyone else. And just look out for it. We'll have some more details coming out for about in the next month or two.
Awesome. Can we get you back? Do yet a separate show just on that topic as well?
Absolutely. We think that's probably going to be the a service that's going to appeal to a lot of MSPs.
So, you know, it's interesting to hear you talk about COVID-19, the coronavirus. You know, obviously that's affected all of us in different ways. For you in New Zealand, that meant... if I heard correctly, 5 cameras total, six overnight stopped scanning. And certainly that can be probably somewhat, you know, frightening for a small business. At least I think something really good has happened as a result of that in terms of the tools that you originally put together for your company. You've now accelerated the development and launch of these tools to now make them available worldwide. I think that piece is super exciting. We're happy to share that message with our community. I would add that I think there's certainly 2 ways to get a hold of you. If you go back to the homeplan.nz homepage, there's a contact us button in the top right. You can get a hold of Scott. But Scott is also a member of the We Get Around Network forum community. It's Homeplan NZ at Homeplan NZ. certainly start a discussion in the forum. Scott, be happy to jump in and answer your questions there. Scott, thanks for being my guest on the show today.
Thank you for having us.
We've been visiting with Scott McKenzie. He's the director of Home Plan, based in Lower Hutt, New Zealand, a Matterport service provider like the rest of us, but I would say probably on steroids, given that you have automated exporting and importing of Matterport tags, the exporting of Matterport labels, your pay-per-view that you'll be back to talk about, and yet a bigger piece that you'll be back to talk about as well. So for Scott in New Zealand and myself, Dan Smigrod, founder of the We Get Around Network Forum in Atlanta, you've been watching WGAN TV Live at 5.